The following program is brought to you by Arlington Community Media, where we tell your story.
This is ACMi News, recognized nationwide as the first place winner of the 2023 Hometown Media Award for News Access.
The Select Board examines a pair of important parking issues in town, which led to a standing room only crowd at the June 26th Select Board meeting. We'll tell you why. Summer just started, but already town leaders want to know if you want a booth for Town Day 2023 this September. Everyone's hoping that we have the same luck weather-wise as we had last year. And a digitally enhanced Jesus Christ Superstar movie comes to the historic Regent Theatre to celebrate its 50th anniversary. And the party didn't stop there. The major players in this groundbreaking musical showed up as well. And everything was all right. Everything was fine. ACMi News starts right now.
From McLennan Park to Spy Pond, from Poets Corner to the Mystic River, we have Arlington covered, giving you stories that count from people who care. Reliable, trustworthy, dependable. This is the nationwide award-winning ACMi News.
Police removed the remains of a dead bear from I-95 on Monday evening, June 19th, just hours after the animal was struck by a car near exit 49A in Lexington. It's unknown if the bear is the same creature spotted on Wilson Farm in Lexington last week. Hello, I'm Ben Lau.
And I'm Paul Werlin. Glad you could join us. Arlington's animal control officer, Courtney Wilson, says it's unknown if the bear is the same creature spotted on the Wilson Farm in Lexington last week. After reports of the highway accident, state police notified the Massachusetts Environmental Police. A spokesperson for the MEP confirmed the reports of a dead bear on I-95, but could not pin down if it was the same bear that wandered through parts of Arlington and Lexington. You'll recall earlier this month, the bear was spotted in Arlington, where it caused a delay in the district school opening and was seen just outside our studios here on Park Avenue, before making its way to the Arlington-Lexington line and Wilson Farm. That bear was also seen in Newton just before making its way here. As of this broadcast, there is no investigation underway to see if it was the same animal. Two major issues involving parking were brought to the forefront at the June 26th Select Board meeting. First, the board chamber was packed with seniors supporting the two-year pilot proposal for senior parking permits. Christine Shaw, Executive Director of the Council on Aging, presented the plan, which includes a parking permit sticker for people 65 and older, allowing them to park at meters and municipal lots free of charge. Each Arlington address would get one sticker only. After some discussion and minor changes, the item was unanimously approved by the board. The pilot is set to start later this summer. Also, the long-talked-about overnight parking measure was approved 4-1 by the board. Get all the facts on the parking issues and the latest on the planned override vote this November by watching the Select Board meeting in its entirety on our website, acmi.tv. Again, that's acmi.tv.
A former Minuteman High School parent has been chosen as Arlington's new Minuteman School Committee representative. Sarah Montague was chosen at the June 21st Select Board meeting. The committee oversees the Minuteman Regional Technical Vocational School District, which draws from 9 municipalities, including some 200 Arlington teens. 4 of the 5 Select Board members voted for Montague. This action follows months of turmoil at Minuteman, including public outcry over Superintendent Kathleen Dawson's decision in the spring not to renew the contract of popular principal George Clement. Dawson has since been placed on administration leave. Kevin Mahoney is now acting superintendent. Clement is also on leave. His future with Minuteman remains uncertain.
So as parents, we experienced the stress that our students and our teachers were going through, and we mobilized for questioning and understanding what was going on. And as you know, we weren't satisfied with the answers that we were given. The school is a gem. The school needs to continue to be a gem. It's time for change in the school committee group. There are parents like us in other towns advocating for change. Lexington had its meeting tonight. We don't know the results of what's happening, but it's time for change. We want to shore up the administration. We want to re-energize the teachers and give them confidence that the school is a gem. We want to give confidence to incoming parents who have been barraged by all of the PR around this. But most importantly, we want the students that are there to understand that they made a great choice and that we are all behind them. Collectively, we are all behind them.
The select board vote ends the tenure of Michael Ruderman, the town meeting member whose three-year committee term is set to expire June 30th.
Are you thinking about setting up a booth for this year's Town Day on September 23rd? Well, now's the time to get going. These are scenes from Town Day 2022, when thousands of people turned out on a beautiful sunny day, the largest turnout in recent memory. And we're hoping for the very same conditions this year. The Town Day Committee is now accepting booth applications. All you have to do is go to their website to sign up, arlingtonma.gov/townday. That's arlingtonma.gov/townday. You have until August 1st to apply. Again, this year's Town Day is set for Saturday, September 23rd from 10:30 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. We, of course, will cover Town Day live, and ACMI News Director Jeff Barn will MC from the main stage and co-anchor this event. We'll also have our ACMI booth set up. We certainly hope you will stop by and say hello.
The Friends of Robbins Farm Park is set to stage an Independence Day concert and picnic with a giant screen starting at 6 p.m. Tuesday, July 4th at the park. Now that we are finally emerging from the pandemic, the public's invited to take in the sounds of the reminiscence live on stage with a larger screen. The event takes place at the park starting at 6 p.m. and is free. If you wish, voluntary donations can be made to the Robbins Farm Park Playground fundraiser campaign. So, bring a blanket and a picnic dinner and be prepared to cut the rug, or grass in this case. We are told pizza and soft drinks will be in sale at the park. And here's wishing all of you a happy and safe Independence Day week with friends and family. The hot, humid, sticky, arid days of summer are upon us. To cool off, you can either pack up the car and drive to the Cape and enjoy the traffic jams, or you can go to the Res. The Reservoir is open for leisure. Season passes are available for purchase online and at the gate. And there's something new at the Reservoir this year. Here's Town Manager Sandy Pooler with an update.
The Res is open from 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. daily, so you can go and swim. It's at 310 Lowell Street, kind of on the western edge of town. You can buy season tickets there at the gate, or you can go to the Recreation Department and buy them online. This year we have two new Moby chairs. These are sort of like wheelchairs with really big tires, so that people with disabilities will have access to the beach and to the water. So I want to thank the work of the Recreation Department and the Diversity, Equity, Inclusion Division for putting those together, and this was paid for through the Disability Commission's budget. So I'm very happy to increase that accessibility and welcome people to come out for a swim.
If you purchased a pass online, you can either stop by Arlington Recreation at 422 Summer Street to pick up your tags, or bring a printed copy of your receipt to the beach the first time you go. To learn more about the Res and all the summer activities, just go to the town website, arlingtonma.gov/recreation.
Saturday, June 24th, was Prince Hall Day here in Arlington. To celebrate the life of this extraordinary abolitionist, Arlington's Historical Society recently hosted a talk on Prince Hall by Arlington High School's Rosemarie Smrzynski at Arlington's Masonic Temple on Academy Street. Who was Prince Hall, and why do we know so little about him? ACMI News correspondent Samyuk DePonth reports that Prince Hall was a fierce advocate for the freedom of enslaved people in the mid-18th century. when it was anything but popular to do so.
There's a lot of unknown Arlington history in this small, peaceful tract of land at 52 Gardner Street. This is the Prince Hall Cemetery, named after the founder of the Black Freemasons and a staunch 18th century abolitionist. Prince Hall was an extraordinary man in extraordinary times, when his ideas and dreams were tragically unpopular.
It memorializes a rare individual, Prince Hall, who was a free African-American man in Boston at the time of the American Revolution. He was probably the most well-known and definitely the leader of the African-American community in Boston.
Prince Hall was a fierce advocate for the freedom of enslaved people in the mid-18th century.
And they wanted to become Masons, but they would not be recognized by any white lodge. And then some Brits, just before the evacuation of Boston, enrolled them as Masons. There were 14 men, including Prince Hall.
He originated the Prince Hall Grand Lodge of Freemasons in 1775 as a community base for Black Americans.
He was a businessman, worked in leather. He had been born in Barbados and came to Boston either as an indentured servant, maybe enslaved. We don't really know, but he clearly was a free person of color in the city during those years.
Arlington's Prince Hall Cemetery now stands as one of the only remaining African-American Masonic gravesites in the nation. At a time when Black Americans had no land to bury their loved ones, the Prince Hall Cemetery was put in trust to lay them to rest well over a century ago.
I happened to live across the street from the cemetery. It was just a vacant lot, and I never thought to ask who owned that property. What was it? It was just a vacant town lot, and I came to find out years later, reading an article in the Globe, that it had been a cemetery.
After Hall's passing in 1807, the lodge was nearly erased from history, until Arlington's Historical Society rediscovered it with the help of the Prince Hall Masonic Lodge in Dorchester.
As you can see, there really are no grave markers here anymore. The grave markers have vanished. It seems like the very last interments were very, very early in the 20th century.
This hallowed ground is now revitalized as the Prince Hall Arlington Cemetery Association and was added to the National Register of Historic Places in 1998.
We're talking about a man who was an abolitionist in the 18th century. You talk about radical. That's incredible.
I don't think he would call it radical. That's the way he wanted to live. This is what he was looking for. And he worked in the interests of his own people. That is to educate them and to make sure that they had satisfactory economic lives, like everybody else.
For ACMI News, I'm Samyukta Pant.
Prince Hall Cemetery was restored more than 30 years ago through donations from the Prince Hall Grand Lodge and the town of Arlington, with the help of its Community Development Block grant funds. Finally, in 1990, the cemetery was rededicated and is now on the National Register of Historic Places. The Regent Theatre received a blessing of sorts for two nights last week, and we do mean a blessing. The historic Regent hosted the 50th anniversary showing of the groundbreaking rock opera movie, Jesus Christ Superstar, the musical masterpiece by Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber. Not only that, the choreographer, the world-renowned still photographer, and three stars from that movie were there in person to tell some fascinating stories about the film and the marvelous and timeless music.
Take this cup away from me, for I don't want to taste its poison.
A little slice of heaven descended upon Arlington last week as the historic Regent Theater hosted the 50th anniversary celebration of the groundbreaking rock opera movie Jesus Christ Superstar, part of a North American tour that runs through late September. In addition to a new digitally enhanced screening of the movie, the show's choreographer, world-renowned still photographer, and three stars from the rock opera were there in person to tell fascinating stories about the groundbreaking film and the timeless music that has spanned generations. Jesus Christ.
Nobody's more amazed than I am. All of we who were in the film can't believe it. Norman Jewison, who, you know, he's a classic filmmaker, and he'd made so many classic films before Superstar. He had just finished Fiddler on the Roof, and then he decided to jump into Superstar. Mm-hmm. He took his script and showed it to all the studios that he'd worked with all that time. Who wants to have this one? And they all said, Norman, nobody's interested in a rock opera movie, especially if it's about religion. Yet nobody's going to come. He said, I'm going to prove you wrong. And he did.
Look, Caiaphas, they're right outside our yard. Quick, Caiaphas, go call the Roman guard.
No, wait. We need a more permanent solution to our problem.
No, I'm constantly astounded that this film has the legs that it has after all these years, to see people coming up for the first time, some of them, and telling us how wonderful it was. I mean, I've seen it a few times, and I think it was ahead of its time in terms of cinematic production. I think it's really great, and I think it will stand to be a jewel.
Jesus Christ Superstar is set against the backdrop of an extraordinary series of events during the final weeks in the life of Jesus Christ, as seen through the eyes of the Apostle Judas. The musical re-examines the rock roots of a restless generation that managed to survive the political turmoil that would ultimately define the turbulence of the early 70s.
That, with the strength of the music and the original work of Tim and Andrew, has just lived. It lives today, and it still speaks to people today.
I mean, Superstar is one that, thankfully, is never going to go away. There's one movie that I've done in my life that is just never going to go away, and that's this one. I'm so happy and so honored to be part of it.
We were kids, and all of us felt like it was a time when we could bring what we were going through in our religious experience, because we were all hippies and reading the Aquarian Gospel of Jesus the Christ, bring that into what we were doing with our technique.
Fifty years later, the music is as fresh as it was in 1973, and the enthusiasm among the principal players is extraordinary.
I get so charged up with energy from how much they appreciate this film, and how many generations have passed it on to their children. That's why it's lasted for 50 years, because the children see it at age 4 or 6 or whatever, and they love it, and then the next generation. It's absolutely magnificent.
Then you are a king, then. It's you that say I am. I look for truth and find that I get damned.
Well, what is truth? Is truth unchanging law? We both have truths. Are mine the same as yours?
Well, last question. So what is truth? Is truth a changing law? We both have truths. Are mine the same as yours?
There must be over 50,000 screaming love and more for you. And everyone of 50,000 would do whatever you ask them to.
For two mesmerizing nights at a jam-packed Regent Theatre, the audience gladly had too much heaven on their minds.
Kill me, take me now, before I change my mind.
We want to thank Frank Munoz, Leland Stein, and Rick Stavros for giving us access to this historic tour.
Because town leaders dodged the raindrops, Porchfest 2023 was a great success. Porchfest is a grassroots music fest where bands play on front porches across town, and people walk, bike, or drive around to enjoy tons of free outdoor music, performances, and the visual arts. It was originally scheduled for Saturday, June 17th, but the all-too-familiar weekend rains came. So, with better weather Sunday, June 18th, Porchfest 2023 rolled out as planned, from 12 p.m. to 4 p.m. in the West Zone, and from 2 p.m. to 6 p.m. in the East Zone. And ACMi News correspondents Lee Rice, Samyuk DePont, and Regan Finch were there.
Hey guys, it's Lee Rice with ACMi. Here we're on East Arlington for Porch Fest. It's a little less of a turnout than last year, and it was postponed because of the rain, but as you can see, it's still got a party going on. It's a much better day outside. It's super sunny and warm, and we can't wait to party with these guys.
Acknowledge a couple of folks here. Yes, my good friend Abe Sali, who's been such a generous supporter of the arts and artists, here with this wonderful Johnny Lapham decorated gas station. It's become such a special place in Arlington Center. Without a further ado, I'll turn the stage over to Back Pocket.
Doctor, 'cause I know what's ailing me. But I don't need no doctor, yeah, 'cause I know what's ailing me. I've been too long from my baby. I'm coming down with a misery. No doctor for my prescription to be filled. I don't need no doctor, yeah, for my prescription to be filled. Lord, in my baby's arms, yeah, can ever take away this chill. Say I need a rest, but all I need is a tenderness. I put me on the critical list, when all I need is her sweet kiss. He gave me medicated lotion, but it didn't soothe my emotions. Yeah.
Sun came out after all. Back Pocket's got a huge crowd going. Everyone's enjoying the music. Porch Fest was a lot of fun this year, and we hope you enjoyed. This is Lee Rice with ACMi. See you guys next time.
This town-wide celebration of music was sponsored by the Arlington Center for the Arts. There was music covering more than 250 porches town-wide this year, with musicians of all stripes being the stars on Arlington's lawns, porches, and streets.
That'll do it for us this week here at ACMi News. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Paul Whirlin.
And I'm Ben Lau. We will see you next week. Take care.
You can always check out our latest segments and newscasts on the web at acmi.tv/news. And don't forget to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram at ACMi News. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. You'll find us at youtube.com/ACMi News. If you have any news tips for us or wish to become a citizen journalist, we'd love to hear from you. Email us at news@acmi.tv or stop by ACMi Studio A at 85 Park Avenue.